first thing to remember about Shelley that is important to remember that helps us understand what's going on here is he is a Neoplatonist. And we've talked about that quite a bit in relationship to Romantic poetry. It also was important with Keats. But he believes that there is this permanent and unchanging truth that exists beyond our immediate actual perception. Those people who have access to and can reproduce this realm of ideal truth are poets. And in the general sense, that can be expressed by anyone who does anything creative, including architects and engineers and legislators, people who write laws which manifest these permanent and unchanging truths. Those people are poets, and they are poets because they are able to perceive this unchanging truth and bring it to us. The first part of this is explaining how those poets gain this power. Shelley is writing this essay in response to a parody essay written by his friend Thomas Love Peacock attacking poetry. And Thomas Love Peacock is attacking poetry on a utilitarian basis. He's making fun of the utilitarians in his parody, but he's attacking poetry on the basis of the argument that it's useless, that it simply is a silly waste of time and it's our imagination running rampant. And that what really matters is not the imagination, but reason. Reason is the supreme power. And remember, we're talking about the early years of the well-developed English empiricist rationalist movement on the beginnings of what we think of as modern science. And this is marked by the application of reason to social institutions and to behaviors and to laws. And so there's this movement to subject everything to the principle of analysis and reason that goes all the way through many authors in the 19th century. So there's this prizing of reason as a power. In the defense, Shelley is arguing that these two classes of mental action, reason and imagination, that even though rationalists claim that reason is superior and imagination is just this sort of recreational power that we kind of waste our time on, Shelley is arguing that imagination is actually the superior power. And it is the superior power because it's imagination that gives us access to this realm of truth, to this supreme level of order. And then reason afterwards, once the imagination has revealed truth, reason then can play with it. But reason doesn't discover anything. It just analyzes what's already been discovered by this other power, imagination. So that's why he says, at the bottom of the first paragraph, reason is to the imagination as the instrument to the agent, as the body to the spirit, as the shadow to the substance. Imagination is the agent, it's the spirit, it's the substance. Reason is the instrument, the body, the shadow. So reason is the secondary power. Imagination is the superior power. The next paragraph explains at length sort of how he derives this idea that imagination is a superior power. In the first place, he starts off saying that poetry is an expression of the imagination. So poetry is the manifestation of the imagination. He starts off talking by that most romantic of musical instruments, the Aeolian lyre. The Aeolian lyre or Aeolian harp or wind harp is something that the Romantic poets just love to use. Aeolus is the god of winds. And what an Aeolian harp is, it is a, in effect, a music box that is driven by the wind. And so it's usually something that one would mount in a window. The breeze would blow through it and it would make a mechanism spin that would produce music. And the Romantics loved it because it was nature making art directly. And so they used this idea of nature making art directly as sort of their image of how the Romantic poet works. Now, both Coleridge and Shelley have this image of the poet as an Aeolian lyre. And the wind is external nature and the sensory stimuli produced by external nature. So the poet is this wind harp, and sensory stimuli produced by the external world around us is the wind blowing through the wind harp and making music. The idea then is that there's this Aeolian harp that the wind blows over and makes noise, but and humans are analogous to that. But he goes on to say, but there's something else in humans that is above and beyond that. And that is that unlike the harp that the wind blows and it makes this direct melody, humans have within them this faculty, which we call the imagination, which produces a harmony to that melody. In music, the melody is the bass song, the bass musical arrangement, and then the harmony is the something above and beyond the bass melody that is original. And that's the imagination. That's this poetic creation that poets are responsible for. Poets have in them, humans have in them, the ability to improvise upon the bass melody. And that improvisation is what we call the imagination. We express this improvisation through language. And that is an attempt to, as he says, prolong the joy. And that's the origin of language, this attempt to create, to prolong our impressions beyond the immediate sensory moment. This language then becomes a way to share it with other people. It becomes the basis of society. And then he says, but we're not going to go into the basis of society and talk about how this works. We're specifically going to look at how poetry comes out of this. So what we notice is that some of the linguistic productions that come as a result of our natural stimuli produce more pleasure than others. And we begin to categorize those kinds of linguistic production that give us more pleasure. And we try to figure out what's going on in them to give us more pleasure. And those people who understand this and are able to reproduce that pleasure are poets. And the standards which judge which things give more pleasure than other things are called taste. He says in this part right here, the highlighted part, there's a certain order or rhythm belonging to each of these classes of mimetic representation. Mimesis is the Greek word from which we get the word imitation. So mimetic representation would be attempts to represent external nature, from which the hearer and the spectator receive an intenser and purer pleasure than from any other. The sense of approximation to this order has been called taste. So taste is the ability to recognize the better orders of representation and mimetic representation from the lesser ones. And those people in whom this taste exists in excess are poets. Their language is vitally metaphorical. That is, it marks the before unapprehended relations of things and perpetuates their apprehension until the words which represent them become through time signs for portions or classes of thoughts instead of pictures of integral thoughts. So poets create language through metaphor, and the language they create is an approximation of the eternal order. The important thing is this underlying thing, that their language marks the before unapprehended relations of things, that their connection through metaphor, because a metaphor, remember, is an implicit comparison between two different things. It's based upon seeing how two different things that are apparently different are actually connected. And so they see the unapprehended relations of things, and they're able to reproduce that order through their poems, which makes them, number one, creative, because they're embodying the imagination, but also makes them, number two, the people who give us order. They give us this ideal realm. This is where the Neoplatonism comes in. They see the underlying order that is the part of the ideal world. And then they recreate it in our world for us through poetry or dance or music or architecture or laws, which are supposed to reflect this ideal order. He goes on to argue that the poets in the larger sense, which includes all artists and all legislators and engineers and architects who create, is the person who discovers those laws according to which the present things ought to be ordered, but he beholds the future in the present and his thoughts are the germs of the flower and the fruit of the latest time. The poet participates in the eternal, the infinite, and the one. As far as it relates to his conceptions, time and place or number or not. So this is the poet going beyond the immediate physical sensory world and going to the ideal world of truth beyond what we just see, beyond what everyone sees, and bringing that truth back to us through their creations. That's what the poet makes a poet, is that they're able to reproduce this eternal order. Then he goes on to talk about how poets in the more restrictive sense are actually the purest poets, because they use ideas in their most unmediated form. Everyone else has to mediate their ideas through something. A sculptor has to work with rock. An architect works with buildings. So he says that the poet is the one who produces the imagination most directly with the least level of mediation, because he says language is arbitrarily produced by the imagination and its relation to the thoughts alone. That which makes poetry is that those linguistic productions which create for us this eternal order beyond our immediate sensory reality. And what distinguishes poetry from non-poetic linguistic production is non-poetic linguistic production deals with facts and details and events that are limited by time, whereas poetry participates in this higher order. And so he says that there are many prose writers who are poets because they participate in this higher order, even though they don't write in meter. And then there are many poets who don't produce anything of any value, and they're really not poets at all. The difference between a non-poetic work is that a story is a catalog of detached facts which have no other bond of connection than time, place, and circumstance, cause and effect. The other is the creation of actions according to the unchangeable forms of human nature as existing in the mind of the creator, which is itself in the image of all other minds. So the poetry gives us the universal.